and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good afternoon, everybody. You will not believe what we've just witnessed here. That wildebeest has just been killed, one of about 3,000 or 4,000 that came streaming across the Mara River. This is the Mara tribe. People, we have just witnessed something quite extraordinary, quite possibly the most amazing wildlife sighting I've ever seen. I'm going to speak in a slightly robotic fashion on account of the fact that my heartbeat is still at about 210 beats per minute. I'm still trying to calm down, and if I allow myself, I will become entirely tongue-tied by what I've just seen. 3,000 or 4,000 wildebeest came streaming across this river. They chose this crossing point because there are no crocodiles here. They came up onto the bank, and then suddenly out of the grass came this lioness, the one that's starting to feed now. She tried 3 or 4 times. She hit one wildebeest. It got away from her, and the very last fellow to come up out of the river, she grabbed, pinned it against that termite mound, grabbed it by the throat, and she throttled the life out of it. Then 2 more came out of the woodlands over there, and down towards here, and you can see, not very enthusiastically feeding. That's because they eat all the time, these lions. At this time of the year, between the end of July and often the end of October, there are wildebeest and zebra and Thompson's gazelles and eland leaping to and fro across this river all the time. They're moving through the grasslands. Some of them die of natural causes. Some of them are young and easy to kill, but basically these lions are eating every day. And so they're not tearing into it like perhaps you might be used to the Nkuhuma pride doing. Now, we are completely live, in case you've just joined us. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv if you want to talk to us. Also on drive today, Jamie and Taylor down in the Sabi sand of the iconic Kruger National Park in South Africa. An entirely different landscape, equally wonderful, very different, and they'll be explaining and showing you some of the regular characters that we have there. These two, not regular characters on Safari Live. We don't know who they are, we don't know where they've come from, and that is the great joy of exploring a new area here. We'll tell you a little bit about the lions and the plan for the day after we've appreciated what we've just witnessed. I hope some of you were able to join us on one or two of our Facebook Live broadcasts just before we went live and were able to see what we just witnessed. We certainly managed to get it onto Facebook, thankfully. It was on Magical Kenya's Facebook Live page and also Barcroft TV's.
She's up.
There we go. She's moving a little bit now. Now, what we came to do here, everybody, was film the migration story to see if we could do a story of the migration, which, of course, is a timeless story of the wildebeest, the zebra, the Tommies, that's the Thompson's gazelle, local parlance. You see, I'm getting very experienced now after 5 days here. And the eland, and how they move in the great Mara Serengeti ecosystem. And we came to show the wildebeest crossing the Mara River, and we managed to do that today, thankfully. And we also came to follow some of the lions of this area. Our main lion characters, the Kichwa Tembo pride, who we've been following for 3 nights now, they're off north of us. On the boundary into the conservancies. There are no fences around this area. They killed a very minute topi this morning. That's a little sesame. So they're still hungry, and we followed them all night last night, well, until about 11:30. They did, well, bar one of them, they did absolutely blow all. These lions are a lot more productive, seemingly, but you can see she's not enthusiastically eating. She's pretty full already, and so I don't know how much eating she's actually going to do today. So later on, we're probably going to join the Kichwa Tembo pride. We'll see if they hunt tonight, and we're also going to hopefully find another wildebeest crossing. It would be unusual for us to find yet another one, but you never know. There are lots of wildebeest massing the other side of the river, and it's quite possible that some of them will try and cross very soon. very shortly. And also, that's just an aeroplane going overhead, everyone. That is the best and most romantic way to come into the Mara, of course. Not via the road that we arrived on. That is likely to knock the teeth out of your skull and fuse at least 6 or 7 vertebrae together. I can highly recommend coming to this area. We are staying at the most magnificent lodge in Africa. It's called Angama Mara. And flying in there is definitely a better option than driving. Yesterday, we opened the show with one of the most famous male lions. And, you know, people talk about big male lions. They talk about being amazed by them. They talk about, well, you know, I saw this big male lion. And I've become a bit jaded over the years. And then I saw this fellow yesterday. His name was Scarface. He's missing his right eye and his right eyelid. He's been stabbed by a Maasai warrior. Survived that. He survived whatever caused him to lose his eye. He's been darted by vets and stitched together every so often. And he is a tough, enormous, massive, black-maned male lion, the most impressive male lion I've seen by a country mile. We saw him yesterday. He's around here somewhere. With any luck, he'll pop out of the bushes and maybe come and share on this kill. Who knows? Chandra, there's a starling over there. Do you want? Every time I point at the bird, Chandra shakes his head because there's so much else going on here. I made him film a rufous-bellied heron as the best were crossing. He wasn't very pleased with me at all. Hello, Shamel. You say what an incredible start to the drive, Shamel. Yes, absolutely. But I got to tell you, this place. You just turn sideways and something more astounding will assail your eyes. Your senses will be so filled, you'll be unable to cope with what you're seeing. And as I've now started to become cliched about, it's a spiritual experience being here. It really is. It's an ancient land. This is where this is where our ancient ancestors first stood on 2 feet and walked across the plains to take advantage of the food that these lions now eat. And you really have to stand on the ground and inhale the air to appreciate the astounding magnificence of it. I'm going to look at that starling, Chandra. You don't have to. It looks like our virtual starling, everybody. Now Chandra has to do it because I've explained it. It looks like our virtual starling, but it's got a white eye. I don't know what it is. Many of you will be keeping a bird list of the birds that we see here. I'm just going to have a quick see if I can't find what it is. There we go. Gosh, there are about 70,000 starlings that you find here. I'm going to go with sharp-tailed. No, he's not a sharp-tailed. I'll keep looking. I will find him. Anybody else? Hashtag Safari Live. Questions at wildearth.tv. If you know what he is, let us know. Could be a narrow-tailed starling, Chandra. No, it couldn't be. It looks like a Birchall's, absolutely. Unfortunately, it has a white eye. Thank you, Graham. Graham, of course, our resident ornithologist. It is called a Rupel's long-tailed starling, is what it is. Rupel's long-tailed starling. Dead wildebeest. 3 lions. Over to the left, 47 vehicles, and beyond them, about 4,000 wildebeest have just streamed across this river. Nowhere in the Kruger have I ever seen lions kill an animal and then leave it. And that's because they are so full of food. It's not like this for them all year round, only between sort of July and the end of October, and often before the end of October, that's when the migration moves on back into the Serengeti of Tanzania. And Chandra is now showing us some beefalo. Thank you, Chandra. It's very kind of you to tear your eyes away from the lions. Ah, goodness. I've got to tell you, being here You always hear how great this place is, and people go bang on about it. But until you have actually seen it, you can't believe that all the rumors were absolutely true. It is that amazing. All right, as things settle down here, the lioness is up. Let's see what she's going to do. Probably lie down again. Let's head across to the ultimately elegant antelope, Jamie Patterson. She is stalking the plains of Juma, cheetah plains in Arethusa. Let's find out what she's going to find you this afternoon. There, that old lioness, she's a veteran of this area, everyone, and she's tired and she's full, and I think that she's had cubs fairly recently. You see that? I think she's had cubs recently. We're not going to hang around here for long. We can come back here and watch them feed. There's just so much to show you here. So what we're going to do is ooze along to the next crossing point, see if there isn't some action there, and we'll go from crossing point, especially while all these vehicles are knocking about over here. And I want to show you on the way just some of the scenes of this place. We'll show you some of the, perhaps the Maasai giraffe and the topi, my new favorite antelope. Well, almost as favorite as the Nyala. And mainly I want to show that to you because Graham Wallington, for some reason, has decreed that I may not show anybody a topi. Hello, Natalie. You're wondering if we've seen any cheetah. We haven't. And you know, we've actually only heard of one cheetah. Hello, everybody. This is where I live now. Jandre is just the other side of the camera, obviously, trying to make things as awkward as possible for me. There is a vehicle in front of us. Natalie, a cheetah apparently are found in this area at various stages, but I've got to tell you, we haven't seen much evidence of them. And I'm not really sure why that's the case. I think there's just too much predator activity at the moment because of the migration being in town. And so there hasn't been a huge amount of cheetah activity. So many lions, so many hyenas about the place, and I think maybe the fact that we haven't seen the cheetah is because of that. Now, the lion story, just while we drive along, I want Jandre to try, or I'm going to ask him nicely, to pan from side to side. It's going to be a little bit jerky, but I'm going to drive as smoothly as possible, just so that you can get a sight of this astounding landscape, as opposed to this astounding minibus going past us. There we are. The lions, when we got here, we were told various things, most of which contradicted everything else we knew about lions, and everything contradicted itself. Look at that. Good grief. We're hoping not to have rain, but those clouds might dump on us a little bit later. What happened was, we have now come to realize that this pride of lions and the lion dynamics here are pretty fluid. And the reason they are fluid is quite possibly because of the migration into this area. We've been following the Kichwa Tembo pride, which turns out so far is 5 lionesses, 2 young males. They were dominated for a while by the great male lion Scarface, he of the missing eye. And we managed to see him yesterday. Then, a number, they're the wildebeest that have crossed the river. Those are the same ones that came across. One of their number currently residing in the jaws of a lioness. And what was I saying? Oh yes, so the Kichwa Tembo pride, Scarface and his brother, whose name is Marana, they were looking after this place. And then 2 blonde males came in from somewhere. We've heard various reports. They came in off the escarpment. They came in from the marsh pride, that they could in fact be related to Scarface. And they've been known as the Marsh Coalition of Male Lions. Well, whether or not that's who they are, we don't know. They came in. Scarface was ousted. They usurped his throne. But strangely, Marana stayed in the area. And he has been sort of almost forming a coalition with the usurpers. And interestingly, while we watched the usurpers calling the other night in the presence of one of the Kichwa Pride females, he was stum. He didn't say a word. He didn't roar at all. And so the story of the lions is being unfolding as we've been here. And so we really have arrived at the most perfect, perfect time. Now, that ain't one of the most quintessential African scenes you've ever seen in all your days. I don't know what is. Gosh, it's amazing. And I'm just going to stop here quickly and ask Gendry to go onto that vulture there. I think it's just a bog-standard issue white back to everyone, but I'm rather hoping it might be a Rupel's. Oh, gosh, Gendry, tell me I haven't lost the binoculars. Oh, this is not good, everyone. Oh, it's okay, I've got them. Oh, goodness. Let's have a look at the Beano's. It is a white-backed, I think. Not a Rupel's. A Rupel's is greyer than that and has a yellow tip to the beak. And, oh, yeah, that's not a Rupel's. We don't find the Rupel's in southern Africa. You can, apparently. Sometimes, but we don't find them at Juma. All right, let's carry on from here. Very nice. Thank you, Gendry. Now, also, just across the river there, just across the way from where you're looking, you are looking in the right direction, there are many wildebeest there, probably about 3,000 or 4,000, and some of them seem to be heading down towards the river. So we're going to go down to the crossing there and see what's happening, and hopefully be able to share with you what we saw earlier, this great mass of wildebeest left and right of the road, coming across the Mara River. They picked that crossing because there were no crocodiles there. They swam. It was a very nice swim for them, I think. It looked very, very pleasant indeed. But then there was a lion waiting the other side. And unfortunately, one of their number got whacked, as it were. Now, Kappa, I think it is, you want to know if the lions are moving from the Serengeti as well. Let's just quickly look at that Thomson's gazelle there. We haven't done a lot of Thomson's gazelle watching. Yeah, look how pretty they are. Snub-nosed. Unfortunately, a wildebeest in the way. There we are. That's a young ram. How cool is that? So cool. Anyway, Kappa, you want to know if the lions move with the wildebeest? Well, one of the reasons that things are so fluid at the moment is that, yes, there are some lions that do move with the wildebeest. Apparently, they get a number of nomads that come along and move with the wildebeest, and that, of course, means that it throws lion dynamics into complete disarray. We've seen two young males, very clearly nomadic, in this area while we've been here, and we're pretty sure that they've come in on the back end of the herds of wildebeest and zebra that have come into the area. Now, I think we're going to skip this particular crossing that we've just gone past, simply because I don't see any wildebeest massing there. And we've just chatted to one of the guides from Angama Mara, which was where we are staying, and she said she has never seen a wildebeest cross at that particular point. So let's see if we... Oh, you see, this is what's going to happen. I'm going to get so distracted. Look at the impala there, Gendry. Now, that's an impala, obviously. You all know that. Look at the size of his horns. That's a fairly small horned one for this area. And they occur in these little groups of 2 or 3 or 4. They're very much not the dominant grazing predators, or at least grazing herbivores here. And the reason for that, of course, is that there isn't any artificial water. Now, we're going to go off to a crossing point, everybody. Let's head across to Taylor, who's got not only lions, she's got elephants. Right, everybody, it's happening. It's happening again. This is the second crossing that we've seen today. Look at this streaming wildebeest. We've watched 4 of them already be taken out by the crocodiles. The zebras have got by unscathed. There's been a hippo in here. There have been some behemoth-sized crocodiles, 15 feet, over a ton. And they're still streaming down over the plains, everyone. They're still streaming from the north into the water. This is the Mara River. This is why we came here. This is the greatest story of the migration. This might be the greatest story of natural history on planet Earth. Now, yesterday we were asked where's the best place to be if you want to cross a river, in the middle of the herd, behind or in front. I said I thought in the middle. I'm now taking that back. I think behind's a much better idea, because the crocodiles are now tired, they've all caught what they want to eat, and these guys are being crossing completely unhindered. That's not to say that one of these great dinosaurs of the deep is not going to emerge shortly and smash one of them. Goodness, we've seen some stuff today, everyone. I don't even know where to look. I'm going to be absolutely exhausted by the time tonight comes along, if it carries on at this rate. Thousands of wildebeest, the last one, seem to be coming down now from the other side. Isn't this amazing? I'd love to hear your thoughts on this. I'd love to hear how this makes you feel. Because to stand here and witness this spectacle firsthand has been utterly profound. It's sights like this that drew so many of us while we were watching documentaries as kids or adults, that drew us to a love of nature, that drew us to a fascination of natural history. And here we stand watching it firsthand and live. Yeah, Darlene in New Hampshire, what a very, very brilliant comment you've made. You said, watching them fills you with the same sense of urgency and fear that they must be feeling as they come across here, the same sense of should we go, shouldn't we go. Absolutely it does. And I got to tell you, it was very sad watching a few of them being pulled under the water by these 15-foot crocodiles. And as Graham said to me one day, he said, you know, a lion hunt is quite difficult to watch sometimes because you want the buffalo or the wildebeest to live, but you're also rooting for the lion. And so it can sort of tear you. Everyone seems to consider the wildebeest, at least the crocodile, the ultimate villain. And so it's always it's an easy decision. You want the wildebeest to kick away from the crocodile. And many of them did. Most of them did. Now what I'm going to do as this last one comes out of the water is just reverse back, and I'm going to try and show you how many of them have come out of the water. We've just got to do this before everyone else moves, otherwise we'll have something of an accident, because there are many, 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 many people here trying to share in this spectacle. Are you right there, Jean-André?
Quite so.
Tell me in one word how you feel. Jean-André feels speechless, everybody. That is a very good state of affairs. I wish we saw crossings more often. Thank you very much, Louise. Louise just said I left my camera on the roof of the vehicle. That's because I'm so excited. Now, let's go round and I'm going to show you the glistening wildebeest as they move onto the plains where they'll graze in safety, hopefully for the rest of the night. But, of course, they may well have the attentions of the lions or the hyenas, the great clans of hyenas of the Mara Triangle. Huge clans of 40 or 50 animals quite often. And we'll just get a long-range view initially. Jean-André, tell me if you've got a picture you'd like to show anyone. Jean-André would like to bank this. That is Jean-André parlance for this looks like I could take a pretty picture. And as usual, Jean-André is not incorrect. That is a pretty picture indeed. Is it not? There are too many pretty pictures here, everybody. It's very difficult to know which pretty picture to take a picture of much of the time. Gosh, how wonderful. This camera is basically on fire. Look at that lone tree sitting there in the plain. This is precious, people. This is precious, precious time we have here. Huh. Yeah, James Richard, you say thank you for panning around. The landscape is almost breathtakingly beautiful. Yeah, I've got to tell you, there's a little bit of a water welling in the base of my eyes as I see what we're seeing here. Whew. There are, like I say, quite a few safari vehicles around, so that's what you're hearing going past you. Oh. Right, Jean-Marie, we'll move now. I think let's the traffic die down a little, don't you?
Yes.
Okay. Come on, everyone. Let's move on slowly. No one can really understand why we've stopped in this position. Why on earth would we stop to have a look at all those things streaming across the plains? Jean-Marie, I know it's not particularly wilderness, but just give an idea to everybody of the number of people here. It's it looks like a lot, but it's only because the action is concentrated. So there are probably far fewer vehicles in this area than there are in a place like the Sabi Sand. But because the action is concentrated over these crossings, sometimes it can seem like there are quite a few. But the landscape is beyond speech. All right, we're going to try and find you another great vista, perhaps some more action. While we do that, let's head across to Jameel Patterson and find out how her little skin, Boki, is doing. There is one wildebeest, everybody, but it is not alone. It seems to be an extremely brave, extremely stupid, or extremely cross wildebeest. It is sitting there staring down the greater population of crocodiles of the Mara Triangle. They are staring at it. It is staring at them. There is, as they say, a Mexican standoff going on here. Whether that wildebeest wishes to come this side, whether he is trying to intimidate them with his nice white beard or curved horns, one cannot say. But what we can say is that this situation is odd. He is lying there on the beach, all alone, staring at, what, 25 crocodiles over there? It's not quite 25, but it's quite a few of them. Now, Jason, while we watch this standoff taking place, you say, what other dangers do the animals face in the river other than crocodiles? It's largely crocodiles, Jason. Animals are very good swimmers. I suppose if the river was in true flood, then that would be a danger. They might drown. I suppose sometimes hippos can get irritated enough to hurt them. And I suppose also that it is possible. Let me move that out of the way. I suppose also, Jason, early on in the season, the wildebeest cross at very steep banks like the one that this crocodile is sitting beneath. And those steep banks create broken legs and maimed backs and all sorts of horrible effects on the wildebeest as they come across the Mara River when they come into the area for the first time around the end of July. Anyway, we just wanted to show you that one wildebeest strangely staring at all of those crocodiles. Why on earth he'd be doing that, no one can tell. Well, Dorothy, you say, it seems that the wildebeest couldn't possibly be that hungry. Why do they continue to kill? Why is it that they must keep killing? Dorothy, you also want to know how often they eat. With a reptile specifically, Dorothy, sorry, it's the crocodiles, not the wildebeest, thank you, Louise. With reptiles like crocodiles, remember they're cold-blooded or poikilothermic, which means that their metabolisms are generally pretty slow. They don't have to generate body heat to stay warm via their metabolism. They must generate body heat through the sun. And what that means, Dorothy, is that they can eat, or they must eat as much as they can when they can. But in times when things are a bit lean, they just kind of slow their metabolisms down. They move into the water a bit when they're too hot, and they move out of the water when they're too cool. And they can go for up to 2 years, like I say, without eating, especially the big crocodiles in this area. But, as with most of the predators out here, they are programmed, basically, to kill. If an opportunity to take a meal arises, they'll take it, almost always. It's the same with the cats. Peter Bratt, our special lion tracker in chief, he's just watched the Kitrotembo pride, who we hoped were going to hunt tonight. They've actually already killed a wildebeest. Hopefully they'll do the same again a bit later on. But they've killed a wildebeest and they're lying around. They're not eating it. It's because there's so much to eat here. They probably didn't have to kill. I thought they were quite hungry last night, but they're not desperately hungry. Those lionesses we watched at the very opening of the show, they were all full. And yet she just came and she obviously saw them coming across the river. She came in, she thought, oh, I'll give this a go. And she caught one of them, killed it. Not very hungry, and so they're just not eating. And so they're programmed to kill, and as I said, very ineloquently, because I was so deeply excited, it's like a house cat. If you roll a ball in front of a house cat, it's going to chase it and pounce on it. It's the same thing with the predators out here. They're programmed to catch things to eat, and even when they're hungry, they're going to do it from time to time when the opportunity arises, because that's just what they're programmed to do. But for these crocs, when the wildebeest and the zebra and the Thompson's gazelles and the eland are not here, they don't eat nearly what they're eating now, and the same goes for the lion. Well, James Richard and many other viewers, you have all come to the conclusion that this wildebeest is probably injured and that's why he's not moving away. I think it's quite possible. He may well have been injured by these crocodiles in the water, managed to get out to where he is now, and maybe he's sitting there in a state of injury. That is entirely possible, guys. We just think it's quite an amusing sort of standoff that's going on here. I'm just trying to see. I'll get my binoculars out and see if I can't perhaps see. There are some hippo floundering around over there. He doesn't look to be injured. He might just be chewing the cud. He may have just been too nervous to cross earlier. And that's entirely possible. I'll tell you why I don't think he's injured, and I don't think that he went into the water there and came out, unless he went into the water around where we are now and floated around there, because the current here is quite strong for them. They do tend to move a little bit with the current. I think that he wouldn't have gone in there and then sort of come out again. Maybe he went in somewhere around here, got caught or got scared and came out and then lay down to chew the cud where he is now. But those crocs took a few steps closer towards him and they might be thinking about trying to press home an advantage, but they won't hunt on the earth unless they're very sure that he's injured. Simon, you want to know, if we were to try and swim across this river, what would the odds of survival be? Simon, I would say the odds of survival of swimming across this river right now, with all the crocs on the bank, 50-50. With all of them in the water, I'd give you a 1 in 30 chance of getting across the river unscathed. They move very fast, they move very stealthily, and most of the time when they're in the water, you can't even see that they're there. Gosh, what an afternoon we're having. The clouds are massing slightly off to the north there. We may well have some rain later on, but we're semi-equipped for it in that we have one bright red umbrella to stick up to protect Graham and Gendre. Mercifully, we had very little. And that's what we're looking at now. There's a tiny little Tommy there. And that little Tommy is going to have to cross with its parents and cousins and sisters and aunts if they decide that that is what they're going to do. We might have to move shortly, just in case they go down to a beach further along from here where the gormless crocodile lives. But, Gendre, I don't know if you can see floating in the water there. Oh, there's a crocodile right there that they've just spotted. Gosh, it must be so deeply exhausting to be thinking about trying to cross this river all the time and worrying about the crocodiles and worrying about the hippos and worrying about being flushed away by the water. These Tommies are small, you know. They're smaller than an Impala, for example. And there are crocs in here. There are absolutely crocs in the water. And look at this one Jana is going to show you now. And that little crocodile, well, he's quite little. He's probably about 6.5 to 7 feet long. He'd very happily sup on a Thompson's gazelle. Not sure these chaps are going to try and cross, but they might. It's worth sitting here and having a little watch. We are live from the Mara Triangle, just to let you know. We've had an astounding afternoon. 2 wildebeest and zebra crossings, one with innumerable crocodile kills, the other with 1 lion kill at the end of it, and that's what we opened the show with. And now we're going to see if the Thompson's gazelle want to come across the river. We've also been spending some time here trying to figure out how it is that these animals operate. How is it that they, what is the movement? Is there some kind of predictability behind it? And I'll share with you my thoughts. Mike in Michigan, before I share my thoughts on why it is I think the wildebeest, or how we can perhaps predict what they do, you say, why, when it seems that there's green grass on both sides of the river, do they run this gauntlet? Do they play this Russian roulette? Here's one in the water now. And they're all going. This is our first Thompson's gazelle sighting. Look at the crocodile coming after them. Oh my goodness. Crocodile smashed. Absolutely smashed. Not a chance. Why would they take this risk, Mike? I don't know why they would. It seems completely ridiculous. Here comes another one. Here comes a 6-foot crocodile that I thought was going to have a go at them. It's coming up just behind this bush here, Jandri. It's going to intercept probably the middle of the herd. Gosh, that was unbelievable. Half of them turned around and decided to go back again. Yeah, look at this crocodile coming in now. Look how fast he's moving. No chance at all these guys have got. Why would they cross? I know this might be difficult for some of you. This is truly incredible. What's the other side there, Jandre? There's a crocodile there, and there seems to be a conflagration under the water. Oof, oh, shame. They're just terrified, poor things. They're absolutely terrified. Their heart rates must be absolutely pounding. Just look over here, Jandri, just over the top of my head there, on the bank. They don't know how they're going to get up now. I feel very sorry for them. They're so little. They're smaller than Impala, just bigger than sort of Diker-sized. Good grief, I can't believe what we're seeing today. David, oh, here they come again, John, other side. They're coming back into the river. David, you want to know, and you're in Napa, and it's how wonderful to hear from you all the way from California. You want to know how many species participate in the migration. David, the main participants are the wildebeest, the zebra, the Thompson's gazelle, the eland. Some topi join it, some don't, some say resident, but those are the main 5. And then you get a couple of tag-alongs, like some of the nomadic lions will move with the migration, but largely it's those 5. I don't think we've even shown you an eland yet. But the elephants will stay resident, most of the topi will stay resident, some wildebeest, some zebra stay resident, the oribi, the Grant's gazelles, and they stay resident. Baby? Sorry, I can't see it. Oh, well spotted. There it is, tiny little thing. Oh, well done, you clever little thing. But really, why did you take the risk? Make a noise, your mum will come and get you. Unless your mum was swallowed by a crocodile. I'm just going to try and take a picture. Well done, well done. You clever, clever little thing. Oh, look, he's just sitting so close to that other car. Oh, now he's looking for the rest of the herd, everyone. I'm sure he'll find the rest of the herd. I hope he does. He's gone. He's just over there. We can't see him now. There's a car in the way. This is an unbelievable afternoon. Gendre has gone pale. He does alternately red and paley, pasty white as his heart rate changes from 200 beats per minute back down to its normal sort of 60 or so. I don't know what to say. There's even some more going on here. What have you got there? And there seem to be some others. Oh, there's a croc popped up there. Oh, yes. James Richard, you say you cannot get over the rush of watching these things cross. James Richard, nor can I. I think this is absolutely incredible. And of course, many of you have watched now a wildebeest crossing. You saw how difficult it was for the crocodiles to catch the wildebeest and the zebra. You saw here how they were just waiting. As soon as the Thompsons went into the water, they blasted in there like, well, they were almost like sort of slightly subsurface speedboats. And they didn't hesitate. And there wasn't a Thompson's gazelle that got through this that was attacked by a crocodile. In other words, every single attack that was attempted followed through. Good grief. We are live, everyone, just to remind you of this. Live from the Mara Triangle, watching a Thompson's gazelle, watching a Thompson's gazelle crossing. Tasha Michelle, you say, dang, how fast are those crocodiles? Well, they're very fast, Tasha Michelle. How fast exactly? I don't know. I've heard they can move on land up to about 40 kilometers an hour. That's faster than Usain Bolt, who runs at roughly 38 kilometers an hour, if you average him out over 100 meters. I think that sounds a bit fast on land, but they've over very short distance, they're very quick. But in water, much, much faster than any human swimmer, any animal swimmer there is, other than perhaps a dolphin or a whale or fish, obviously. But no mammal will be able to outrun them. I'm not sure, I couldn't give you an exact speed in knots or miles per hour. But it's very quick. You saw that bow wave that rose out of that crocodile as he leapt into the water, his tail swishing from side to side, driving him forward. Woof. Well, I'm just looking out behind us to see if I can see the little gazelle. But that gazelle seems to be okay. I think he's made it off. Perhaps he's joined the rest of his herd. I hope he has. Ooh, look, look, look. Johnny, croc there. Oh, good grief. Am I right? Just everywhere you look here, something is going on. So I guess a Thompson's gazelle, almost small enough for a croc to be able... Oh, that croc's chasing each other now. Look at them, having a fight there. This is unbelievable, as Louise says. It's just, we don't know where to look. If you look to the left, you'll miss something on the right. It is amazing, though, the effect that water has. Water, obviously, it may sound like a stupid statement, but water, a driving force, of course. And the little croc has got a piece of Tommy there. Here we are. Water, the driving force of any ecosystem. But when you've got a river like this, it really is the center of every single piece of action. I think if you were to come back here, though, remember this, in January and February, when all the wildebeest are calving on the southern plains of the Serengeti, then, however, I think things would be a lot quieter here. There'd still be beautiful, there'd still be plenty of elephant and buffalo to see here, there'd be plenty of warthog and impala, the odd resident wildebeest and zebra, but you wouldn't get these great crossings, and of course all the predators are resident, bar the odd nomad. But this time of the year, it's no wonder it's one of the most popular wildlife destinations on planet Earth. Whew. Hello, M. Spicer. You say, are the gazelles easier to catch, or are they just a sort of preferred meal for the crocodiles? Do they just like to catch them, or do they taste better, perhaps? No, they're definitely easier to catch, and there's a very simple reason for that. They're half the size. They're a quarter the size of a wildebeest. I mean, they're minute things. I'll give you the exact mass, but I think they probably weigh about 30 kilograms each, which is about 66 pounds. So they really are not very big in the slightest. I'll just confirm that for you exactly, but I think if I remember my studying that I did before I came here, that is correct. Yeah, female up to 25 kilos, a male up to 35 kilos, so yeah, round about, actually even less than 66 pounds, probably between 40 and 50 pounds. Really quite something. We have had some luck today, everyone. And just a summary, I mean, we came here, this is the story we came to tell. We came to tell the story of the wildebeests and the zebras and the tommies coming across the river. And the lion hunting. And, well, we thought it was a great risk coming here. We didn't know that we'd be able to do that. And the first 3 days made it quite difficult to show a crossing. But there it is. We've seen three in 1 day now. There's a buffalo, everybody. A beefy buffalo of the Mara. He's a bit old and he looks a little bit weak and tired of life. You can see he's got hips sticking out. But the lions here that we've seen don't often kill buffalo because there's so much else to eat. I think they probably kill them a lot more come the time when the migration is not here. I can't believe this. Phew-wee, I wonder if these other tommies are going to come across. The crocodiles are massing. They can't believe it. They love to catch these tommies, obviously. Simply because, well, they're much smaller, like I said. They're much smaller than the wildebeests and the zebras. And just to keep you updated, our lion tracker-in-chief, Peter Bratt, a.k.a. technical director, he is with the Kitchotembo Pride now. They have killed a young wildebeest. They may go hunting later on. We are not sure, but we will go and take a look. We're also going to have a brief look, perhaps, at those other lions, but we have got a friend standing by there. We were rather hoping Scarface, the big male, might come out and share the kill with them. But so far, we haven't heard anything. Whew. There's a couple of crocs floating down the river, having a bit of a spat over some tommy steaks for supper. Hello, Oki. You want to know if crocodiles have any natural predators? Oki, they do. Normally other crocodiles, actually. When they're very little, though, quite a few things will eat them. Storks and herons, they will eat very tiny hatchling crocodiles. Once they get above that sort of size, though, not a huge amount other than other crocodiles will try and eat them. You will get big birds, I suppose, will come. Maybe the odd fish eagle, perhaps a marabou stork. But it would be largely birds, I suppose. There they go, over the rapids. And I wonder if that little croc won't try and stash that tommy underneath one of the rocks here. Oh, there's a wildebeest now. A wildebeest now massing on his own, perhaps for a drink, but maybe a solo crossing. That would be brave. In fact, it would be stupid. I'm going to move the car slightly, Jean-Ré. Just how are we there behind, Graham? Just asking him to move forward 3 feet. I just want to move slightly because I think we're going to miss Oh, yeah, care behind? Sorry, I just wanted to move in case he came across where we'd have the best possible chance to see him cross. Now, you can ask us questions. We are live, barely. The excitement has nearly given us all a heart attack. Hashtag Safari Live, questions at wildearth.tv. And that wildebeest is quite a long way away. I suspect he's just thinking about having a drink, rather than actually crossing. Hello, Kathy in Washington. You're wondering whether wildebeest cross to and from more than once a day. I think sometimes they do, and I think that this particular bunch that we saw crossing today, the thousands that we saw, I think they've gone in a great big loop, either yesterday or today. They go all the way north into the conservancies to the north of the triangle, and they turn and they come south across these river crossings here. I think that's what happens. It's very difficult to know, though. We might, if your screen does go black, it's because the battery has gone, and we will change it and bring it up as soon as possible. So we see, just to keep you posted, we do need to change the battery, but I think it might be worth just seeing what this wildebeest does. Now, Jandre says he thinks it's okay, everyone, so let's just watch and see what this wildebeest does. I can tell you, we're not going to show you because there are lots of cars in the way, that there is a very large rainstorm in the west, pounding water onto the Olulolo escarpment. It's mercifully far away from us, but the rains do look like they're massing, as they have every single afternoon. I think this wildebeest wants to go across. I wonder if he isn't the same chap we saw eyeballing the crocodiles earlier. We're in a perfect position here, everybody. This is called the main crossing, and like I say, there are 10 crossing points throughout this area. Most of the ones to the south of where we are A, quite far away from all the lodges, and B, used normally earlier in the season. Those are the ones with the very steep banks where the wildebeest managed to maim themselves leaping over the edge. This chap is being very indecisive, but you know, the wildebeest is not the most decisive animal in the world. Monty, you want to know how wide the river is where they cross. Monty, the river here, I would say, is about 100 meters wide in some areas, and as narrow as, say, 70 meters or so in others. So that's about 330 feet around the sort of rapids. Maybe a little bit wider than that, 300, maybe very maximum 400 feet. And then at the narrower areas, like where we first watched the wildebeest crossing in the very deep water, it's probably only about 70 meters, 60 meters or so, so about 200 feet. Now, let's watch this wildebeest walking up towards us. Now, this is not a kind of traditional crossing point. Now, the thing about the rapids is that, yes, they're shallow, so the wildebeest gets purchase, but the rocks underneath mean that they can easily get stuck in a crevice, break their legs. Watch out to the main crossing there, Jandre. The Tommies seem to be coming down, so we'll just keep an eye on that. So ideally, for safety's sake, well, physical safety's sake, the wildebeest would like deep water, but when they're in deep water and there are crocs there, the crocs then have all the advantage. I've seen many wildebeest get away from the crocodiles where the wildebeest are able to stand on the ground and push off. But when they're actually fully swimming, like those poor Thompson's gazelles were doing, then they don't have a chance that the crocs have a go at them. They just get dragged under the water very quickly indeed. Ah. does feel deeply, deeply satisfied here. What do you think, Gendre? What kind of money do you give him trying to get across this river?
A wager.
I say... I don't know. I actually can't tell. I'm so jaded by my inability to tell what these things are going to do. He's thinking about it. He's trying to find a spot. But he's going towards where the Thompson's gazelles had that really nasty experience earlier. He's come away from the beach where he originally started, because just across the way from there, a carcass of one of his cousins is floating. So who knows? Hello, Miss Lynn. I don't know. We were debating this earlier. You said these crossings go on during the night. Miss Lynn, I don't know if they do or not. And that's because we don't come down here in the night time. I suspect sometimes they do, yes. I'm not sure how often. I think you know with most herbivores, they tend to go into open areas and go to sleep for the night, or try and sleep, or sort of mass in clearings where they can see what's going to come and get them. So I think the likelihood of them crossing is probably quite small. That said, I don't know how active crocodiles are at night, and I don't know how well they're able to actually see at night. So maybe they do a bit of night crossing. Sorry, I just have to turn here so that Gendre can get a better picture of the wildebeest. Yeah, no, he's seen that croc. There's a croc tracking him. There's a croc tracking him as he goes. There he is. And this is a dangerous place for a crocodile to be. There's a hippo out of the water now. He also seems to be tracking the wildebeest. The wildebeest is looking at the crocodile while the hippo turns about. Not sure what he's doing. Perhaps he's decided he's had enough in the water. Skin's feeling a bit wrinkly, getting a bit peckish, going to go and have some grass to eat. Or not. Maybe just wanted a bit of a stretch. And all the while, the wildebeest is just moving up. What a day we've had. Looks like that hippo's being tracked by the others. But they all look much smaller, so maybe that's the bull from the pod. That's so cool to see. Got the light changing now. Beautiful light now coming onto the river. And there, that big bull just went. Just a wonderful sound. Well, let's have one last look at the wildebeest, and then I think we're going to move on from here. We'll maybe go and have a look at the Kitchotembo pride, and I think we're going to move towards the north as the sun begins to set and catch them before it gets dark. Marvelous, marvelous, marvelous stuff. Glorious light, endless animals, action, sadness, happiness, tragedy, story, and a little bit of comedy, especially from the crocodiles and the wildebeest. I mean the wildebeest, of course, who was facing off the crocodiles. Right, excellent stuff. Continuity is what we want. Let's go from here, where we've had wildebeest, to Jamie Patterson. Well, everybody, there is Morana, the male lion. That's who we think he is, anyway. And we think, from our intel, we've been doing much intel gathering. I feel like the entire branch of MI6, We have been gathering intel, and we think that that is Morana, the brother of Scarface, that quite epic male lion we saw yesterday. He's stuck his head up, only because we came along, I'm afraid. But there he is, but next to him is one of the, I think, from what I can tell, one of the blonder males, one of the other males of the coalition that come in here and killed the cubs. And what's interesting is he's clearly young, he's got still a bit of pink on his nose. But what's interesting is that apparently Morana, when these blondies killed the cubs, for some time was seen with the cubs and spending time with them and their mothers. And he took no part in killing them, but he also obviously took no part in defending them while his brother Scarface was across the river. Perhaps he feels a sense of shame. No, he's a magnificent boy. Look at him. Jeepers, he's big. Yeah, no, it's not surprising that he is the brother. I think we should go to the thermal for this one. There we have the lion, and just behind him a little patch of warmth you can see on the thermal camera. And look how cool his mane is, A. And B, this is the lion we saw flicking his tail on the first night we did this, and he's got no pom-pom. And that's why his tail ends rather abruptly, as opposed to in a semi-dark pom-pom. That was an astounding thing to see. Oh, wonderful. Excellent. All right, let me just move slightly. Johnny, I'll try and get the front IR in on the sleepy one, other sleepy one, and the side one on the other sleepy one. There we are. Look at that. They've lain perfectly for our infrared lights. Let's go slightly closer and turn off here. In fact, we might try and go around the other side shortly. We'll just see what they do for a few minutes. I was told today that they were very full. I don't think they look particularly full at the moment. But male lions, well, you know, they do tend to be rather lazy scavenging things. Yeah, he's quite full. Yeah, I know, he's got a belly on him. That lion is very sleepy. Still, there is so much food around. Perhaps a wildebeest will come wandering past here. Perhaps a zebra. But he doesn't look like he's going anywhere too soon, does he? The other characteristic, apparently, of Morana is the fact that he is missing one of his bottom canines. And if he is Scarface's brother, as we suspect, well, then he is also between 10 and 12 years old, I think. Now, let's just have a listen to the sounds of the Mara night, and I'll tell you what I can hear. I'm just going to stand up again. All right, let's be quiet, everybody. Hear some frogs, some insects. I can hear one species of frog going at a waterhole off to the right of where we're sitting now. Perhaps where Morana and his blonde brother will go. Well, not brother, coalition mate. Don't know what they are at this stage. It's really a fascinating story to be unfolding here, and I'm sad we won't be able to do it for the next few months here, but we'll keep updating you as and when we hear anything back in South Africa. But otherwise, all is silent, much as it was yesterday. It's just a beautiful, beautiful night. Valeria, in Massachusetts, you say, isn't it unusual that he should leave his brother? Or sort of forsake him, if you like, do a bit of a Brutus a la Julius Caesar on him. It is unusual, but is it? So, yes, it's unusual as far as the textbooks say that it's unusual. Is it unusual for this area, for the Mara Triangle, for the Mara, during a migration when the wildebeest are in situ and the wildebeest and the zebra are coming up as well? I don't know. I'm going to hesitate to say, yes, it's unusual. Certainly in South Africa, we would consider it extremely unusual. But apparently, the migration, when it does come up here, creates an enormous, enormous amount of upheaval in the lions. And often, the migration brings with it nomadic males and nomadic lions who are without territory. And sometimes that brings upheaval. I'm going to guess, though, that old Scarface is born of quite a lot more testosterone than his brother. Although his brother is pretty dark-maned. Maybe his brother is just bigger. And I'm going to suggest that he was the dominant lion, and that when these guys came in and had a go at him, well, I guess I really hate myself for saying this, but a bit like Scar in The Lion King forsook his brother Mufasa, so perhaps Morana forsook his brother so that he could kind of get on with life and not be beaten up. That was not a conscious decision he made, but I think it's quite possible that in order to reduce conflict, he acted in a submissive fashion to the new males. And certainly the reason I think this is because the first night when we were watching them, we had the female, and she was calling, and these two blondies were calling, but Morana was absolutely stumm silent. So I think that's quite interesting. Right, back in South Africa, the wonderful Nkuhuma Pride lionesses are on the hunt. Let's go and take a look. So, rather unlike in the Sabi Sand, where the Ninkapumas are now walking through woodland, here, with the thermal camera, it's pretty easy to follow lions when they're moving, if they're moving. This particular lion is not moving. He's just put up his head, though, and he's sitting underneath a gorgeous tree there, sort of sticking out on its own in the clearings. Now, why he's got his head up is because he's centered on the wind, something that Graham has found with the thermal camera. So we'll just have a quick look at the thermal view. That's me there. Hello, everybody. And there's the thermal view. Those are zebras. And they're not walking straight towards us. They're kind of walking parallel with us and possibly around. And that's why he lifted his... That's why he lifted his head, because their scent is blowing straight towards him. I just stopped speaking there briefly because it looked like there was a hot spot in the middle of that shot. But I don't think that's anything. So there go the zebras. The lions, like I say, I think look pretty full. So I'm not sure they're actually going to do anything. We knew the game was up yesterday evening, you know, when those lions started calling. The females started calling, advertising their territory, and we knew that they were no longer going to be on the hunt. This fellow's decided that he's got very dirty nails that he'd like to clean. What with it being Friday night and all. Jeez, this is amazing. Hello, Spencer. You're a new viewer, and you ask a very good question. You say, is it common for lions to be nocturnal hunters? Spencer, it is not only common, it is typical in many areas that they are nocturnal hunters. Now, I would have said before I came here that they're almost exclusively nocturnal hunters. They will take the opportunity during the day if they can to hunt, but often they don't. Now, in the Mara here, because there's so much around, at least four, I mean, of the four or five kills we've heard of while we've been here, one of which we've witnessed, they've been during the day. Then we've witnessed one at night, but we've watched many failed attempts yesterday evening. So the lions here do kill during the day, and lions will take the opportunity to kill whenever they can. So it's not necessarily only during the night time that they kill. It's a good question, Spencer. Leopard as well, I think, do a lot more of their killing during the day than we think they do. He is deeply, deeply fatigued by life here in the Mara Triangle. But he's not panting, which means that he's not really that full. I think the blondie is probably fuller than Morana, if that is him. Now, that blondie there that we're looking at is missing a bottom right canine. And I think I confused the information I got today by saying Murano was missing his bottom right canine. I think it's this blondie. He's also got a very dirty face. Yes, you do. That's correct. A dirty face. Mm-hmm. And big claws. Yes. And it almost looks to me like he's got a torn left ear. Ah, wonderful question from Belly the Backpacker. Belly the Backpacker, you want to know how much more food these lions eat compared to the lions of the Sabi Sand. At this time of the year, I'm going to say I reckon they eat probably 20% more. Although, you know, given the drought that there's been, Kahuma Pride has been eating a lot of food lately. They've been killing many of the buffalo. And they kill bigger prey there, seemingly, than they do here. But there's so much now between July and October for these chaps to eat that I'd say they probably eat 20% more at this time of the year. But when those zebra and wildebeest and Thompson's gazelle and eland head out of the Mara, things become a little bit more lean. They don't become impossible, but they become leaner, and I think you'll find they probably eat, I don't know, maybe 10% less than the Nkuhuma Pride does in the height of a drought. It really does vary on the time of year, though, so how to answer whether or not they eat more in total than the Nkuhumas, I don't know. I don't know how I would answer that question. I'm going to say maybe slightly more, but given the... Well, I mean, given the difference in prey or the number of prey species when the migration moves off to the south, I'm going to say it's probably very similar. Well, this is more activity than we had last night for those lions after bar the three little hunts. And those wildebeest are now well past. They're not walking towards him anymore. So he's no longer scenting them on the wind. They've moved out of the wind trail. But maybe he'll sit up and give us a call. Maybe he'll flop down and go back to sleep. He looked almost like he might have been enthused enough to get up there. No? Don't you want to go and do something, hunt something? There's lots around. Won't be here forever. See the wind starting to pick up a little bit coming out of the north. Fiona, that's a very interesting question. You want to know if I think lions have a preference, if they like to vary their diets, if they get bored of the food that they eat and think to themselves, gee whiz, if I have to eat another wildebeest, I'm going to be sick. Give me a zebra or some warthog. Fiona, I don't know. I mean, I'm assuming the meat must taste different. Do they have taste buds as sophisticated as ours? Absolutely not. I think we've got the most taste buds per area on our tongues than any other animal in the world. So I wouldn't say that the taste necessarily bugs them too much. So I'm going to say no, I don't think they necessarily get sick of things. What they will start to do perhaps, though, oh gosh, there we go, fast asleep. What they will start to do, if in perhaps they're in a drought time, they'll start to notice the lack of fat on the animals they're eating, surrounding those crucial organs, the liver and the kidneys, and possibly even the lungs. They'll notice the fat disappearing from that in a drought, and they will notice the... Well, I mean, physiologically, they will notice the lack of fat in the diet. Does that then translate to them trying to catch something a bit fatter and fattier? I don't know. Certainly it would with elephants, not, for example, I know they're not going to eat meat, but they are intelligent enough, certainly, to go off and try and eat different kinds of foods depending on what their physiologies happen to be lacking. But I don't know about these lions. Very nice question. I like those ones. Not able to answer them properly, which means that it makes us all have a good think. Brilliant. Yeah, I don't know that these chaps are going to do anything tonight. We may do a little traverse around just now to see if we can't find the lioness who who had been with that dark-maned male. Hello, Cecilia. You want to know what other predators are around here, other than the lions and the hyenas? Well, there are cheetah here. I think that they're making themselves scarce at this time of the year because there are so many other predators. There are lots of lions here. There are nomadic lions who are not normally here. They're kind of here for the festival of the wildebeest at the moment. There are many, many hyenas, as you saw. Likewise, there are probably a couple of nomads knocking about here. And that means that the cheetah will be scarce. You can almost predict a cheetah's distribution by the presence of male lions and even their calls. When a male lion calls, it's highly unlikely you'll find a cheetah nearby, because they are the main killers of cheetah, more often. And so, I think you'll find not many cheetah here at the moment. Probably in 4 months' time, or maybe even 2 or 3 months' time, there'll be more cheetah activity. There is one cheetah around here since we've been here. We think she's quite a famous cheetah called Matilda. What a name for a cheetah that is. Anyway, we think she's around this area, but we haven't been lucky enough to see her yet. Then, of course, the aardvark, which is a kind of hyena. It's quite possible to get a striped hyena here sometimes. Maybe a wild dog. Definitely a serval, which we saw. We saw a few servals and possibly African wildcats as well. The Nkuhuma pride are behaving completely unlike these two lazy males. They're up and at it and on the hunt. Let's go and take a look. Look, everybody, we've moved, and we've moved because the lions have not moved. We're just trying to get a slightly different perspective on things, and as you can see, well, there isn't much of a different perspective on things. Let's have one look at the FLIR camera, at least the thermal imaging camera, and we'll show you the lion first, and then we'll scan slowly from side to side and see if we can't see some prey coming this way. One of them did lift its head briefly. There's the other one, lying very sleeplessly, at least sleepfully. And otherwise, these clearings seem remarkably free of life, which is strange. There's the beginnings of the Ololo escarpment. There's a big herd of probably wildebeest or zebra or buffalo up there. Clearly nothing these lions are too concerned about. And I think the reason everything is not hunting right now is that so much food came into this area today. We woke up this morning, looked down over the escarpment, down onto the ground, onto the valley floor here, and there were wildebeest massing by the tens of thousands. Anyway, I think one or two of them got whacked during the day, devoured or eaten, or even last night, perhaps. And they are no longer feeling the need to eat. We haven't seen these lions hungry. They've been basically fat for the last 5 days, almost a week. There they are. And so deeply, perfectly content. And of course, they are making hay while the sun shines, which of course all animals should do, including ourselves. The reason they're doing that, well, there's lots of food here now. It won't be here forever. I'm very interested to see that the Nkuhumas are on the hunt. It would be so wonderful to get them on the hunt and actually killing again. We have had them once or twice on the hunt, of course, but it's not that easy to following them. Ellen, you're in Arkansas. You say, how far from the river are these lions? And it's a very good question, and you're justifying it by saying, surely it would make sense for them to hang around at the crossing points. I think some of those lions do. Certainly the one that we saw killing today, we saw a lion killing a young wildebeest as it came out of the river today. Yes, they seem to lurk about in the areas around where the crossings happen. I think it's a bit of a stretch to suggest that they have actually learned precisely where all of Wildebeest cross, because then I do think, Ellen, that there would be lions around those crossings all the time, and those crossings would then not be crossings anymore, because much like with the crocodiles, I think the Wildebeest would work it out. Except that's actually rubbish I'm talking now. I don't think the Wildebeest would work it out. They seem to cross regardless with the crocs. But I think if there were lions on the ground, they'd probably learn to avoid the area eventually. Anyway, I do think it's a good question, though, and I wonder, I mean, certainly in South Africa, we know that, anywhere where there is water holes as opposed to rivers, we know that lions concentrate around those water holes, because they know that their prey have to come and drink. But I think there's just so much going on over here. There's so much to eat away from the rivers that there's no real point for the lions to go knocking about and lurking on the riverbeds all the time. So that's what I think's going on here. I'm just going to describe what I can smell. Much like the lion, I'm tilting my nose to the air. I can smell smoke in the air, interestingly. I wonder if there isn't a fire somewhere not too close to here, or not too far from here. I can't smell the zebra, though. I will tell you that one of the roads we drove yesterday, though, had a very distinctive smell of very fresh wildebeest dung. Taylor has managed to re-find the mobile lions of Juma. Let's go and take a look.
The lion has moved his tail very slightly to the right-hand side. There. Oh, look at that. A back leg is moving. Good. Excellent. Nothing else has happened. I'm very, very pleased that you've had the nincompoops there on the hunt. But of course, it is quite thick in there. And so I hope that Jamie and Taylor manage to relocate the male, because of course, he will then look fairly, well, it'll be a good opportunity for you to compare him with these two here. But really, they are beyond flat cat at this stage. Anyway, we're going to sit with them for a bit longer and let's see what they do. Let's have a quick recap. We're coming to you from the Mara Triangle, completely live. My name is James Henry Jandre is on camera. And also in the vehicle, I've forgotten to introduce you during the course of the day. Mrs. Wallington is sitting in the back. Mr. Wallington operating the thermal imaging camera behind, and in the front seat here we have Daniel, an Askari from the Olulolo Gate, and he is just keeping a watch on us, keeping us safe, and it's a great privilege to have him with us. We are in the Mara Triangle doing two things. We're trying to tell the story of the lions here, and also the story of the migration. And we've had an astounding day today. We saw three crossings, one with just wildebeest, thousands of them streaming across the plains, at least across the river. And then the last one, the very last one to come out of the water, being smacked by a lioness. She took him down, pinned him against a termite mound, and snuffed the life out of him eventually. The first thing she did, though, was a little difficult to watch, was that she suffocated him. He obviously lost consciousness because he couldn't breathe anymore. And then she let go because she was tired. And then he started to breathe again, so he got up and she had to grab him again. And that was a little disconcerting to see. Anyway, that's how it is out here. And that kind of savagery, awe-inspiring as it is part of what it is to live here in the wilderness. Then two other lionesses, we don't know who they were, joined her. Nobody seemed to know exactly which pride of lions they were, but it was a new set of characters for us here in the Maasai Mara Triangle. Then, after that, we headed off towards another crossing point, and a mixed herd of wildebeest and zebra dived into the water where just before they'd been chased off by some crocodiles. The crocodiles went crazy. Huge 15-foot reptilian dinosaurs of the deep went leaping around, and they caught, I think, three or four of the wildebeest there. I don't think they managed to get a zebra, did they, Jandre? I think they just managed to get a couple, four or five wildebeest. Then they kind of floated off down the river, and I thought to myself I'd made a mistake, because we were asked the other day, where is it best to be, front, middle, or back of the herd? And I thought, well, I'd want to be in the middle. Turns out that's not the case. Lions aren't moving, are they? No. I thought I heard something. I thought I heard a pussycat. It turns out the back of the herd is the best place to be, and that is because the lions... Oh no, sorry, it's Daniel moving around here that I keep hearing. That's because the crocodiles, once they've got their prey, they float off down the river, and then they ignore everyone else coming across, so that was a good place to be. Then we went to check on another crossing to see if anything was going on there. We had a rather amusing scene of one lonely wildebeest facing off. He was sort of lying down on the banks of the river, looking at about 15 crocodiles who were staring up at him, and I thought it was quite an amusing scene. And then we thought we'd take one more look at the main river crossing, where, for me, one of the highlights of the day, you know, probably not the highlight, but one of, Thompson's gazelles coming into the water and swimming across. Now, Thompson's gazelle is a tiny thing. They're probably only, what did they, we decide? We decided they're between 25 and 30 kilograms. That's between sort of just over 50 pounds and 50 and between 50 and 65 pounds only. So they're tiny. They leapt into the water, they prevaricated for a while, as all the animals do, leapt into the water, and the crocodiles immediately gave chase. They shot into the water like reptilian speedboats, swishing their tails from side to side, and when they caught up with two or three of the Thompson's gazelles, they just grabbed them in one bite, pulled them under the water, and that was the last we see of them. There wasn't any of the kicking or fighting that the wildebeest managed to do. When those crocs came up to the Thompsons, they grabbed them, didn't matter from which side, front on, side on, back on, didn't matter, they dragged them under the water and they were gone. And the highlight of that little sighting was a tiny Thompson's gazelle. Couldn't have been bigger than that. It managed to swim its way across unscathed, climb nimbly up the bank, seemed to find the rest of the herd, and off it went safely. How many times it's going to have to cross that river and how many times it's going to do that, play that roulette without losing its life, well, no one knows. But it's an amazing thing to see. Then we went off to try and find the Kitrotembo pride. They very ill-manneredly killed a wildebeest while we were watching the crossing. They are fat and very asleep, as are these two male lions now. Shall we have another look at them, Jandro, rather than my mug? There we have it. Hello, Angie. You're wondering if there's any animal that might terrorize a crocodile? Angie, no, not really, you know. I think the thing that terrorizes a crocodile most is another crocodile. I have seen footage of leopards giving crocodiles a go. And we all know that the jaguars eat the caimans sometimes in the Amazon. But very little, I mean, very seldom. Sometimes lions will give crocodiles a bit of a hard time, but I didn't think anything terrifies them. Once they're in the water there, very little will have a go at them. I think maybe the main terrorizer of crocodiles, come to think of it, is the other water dweller, the other large water dweller, and that is the hippopotamus. I think crocs are nervous of hippos, they avoid them, they don't like to go towards them too much, and certainly we've seen times where hippopotamus have rescued animals being devoured by crocodiles, they've rescued them away from the crocs, and we had an amazing, I mean today, while the crocs were sort of creating their mayhem, snapping hither and yon with their great big jaws, pulling wildebeest under the water and pulling zebra under the water, interestingly, one of the big hippo bulls from the pod that lives quite around about the main crossing point came up and sort of got in the way of the migration moving across the water, and we don't really know why that was. The wildebeest certainly tried to avoid him, but I don't know if the crocs then tried to avoid him, if he was trying to stand on one of the crocodiles, I don't know. But certainly crocodiles avoid hippopotami when they can. Difficult to believe these lions are actually alive. James Richard, very appropriate question. You say, since we've already achieved everything we set out to here in the Mara, is there anything we want to see before we leave? Anything on the wish list? Yes, there is. That's why we're sitting here with two male lions. We're rather hoping to see a male lion get off his lazy cat bottom and go hunting. We'd really like to see a male lion do something other than lie about the place. There's just so much food around, though, that I don't think these things are going to move for love nor money tonight, unless a zebra happens to stand on them, or a warthog happens by on his way home from the pub, or perhaps a wildebeest herd decides that they're not going to follow the normal path and heads up onto these grasslands. Otherwise, I think these male lions are going to sleep soundly. It's a warm evening. There's a bit of wind blowing now, but otherwise everything is completely calm and very pleasant out here, I must say. It was about 32 degrees Celsius, I suppose. That's about 85 degrees Fahrenheit. No, it's not. Is it? Yes, it is about 85 degrees Fahrenheit today. So very pleasant. Fran, sorry, I missed your question. We see, can we have it again? It's interesting that, Fran, you say, will these males be more tolerant of the nomads coming into the area than perhaps the Birminghams would, because there's so much more food around? Fran, I think they probably would. I mean, there are nomads around. We've seen them. We've seen these guys in the same vicinity as the nomads. So, well, what we think are nomads. So, yeah, I think there probably would be. And I think it's probably precisely because there's so much food around, there's just not much threat. I think were those nomads to go towards their pride, if they happen to be around the prides, or if they happen to roar, the nomads, or start marking territory, I think the tolerance would be infinitely less than it is now. But yeah, I would say there probably is a certain amount of increased tolerance given the amount of food.
Zebras are running this way.
Zebras seem to be running this way, everybody. Chief thermal camera operator G. Wallington says the zebras are massing this way. There they are. Apparently they're alarm calling. Oh, they're heading this way. Oh, what's happened there? Oh dear. They seem to have had some sort of power cut. Never mind. There the flare's back up. Louise is saying, is there a fourth blob there? I'm looking at it now, Louise. There does seem to be some running, though.
They're running hither and thither.
They're running hither and thither. There's the sort of semi-missing ear, I think. They are running hither and thither. Let's go back to the thermal camera, Gendry, if you don't mind. But now they do seem to be running straight towards us. There they are. They're coming straight here, aren't they? This is astounding. Are the lions up? We better have a quick look at the lions. Up, yes, but facing the opposite direction. Wake up, you idiot. The zebra's coming. Yes, the wind has changed direction. Look, it's blowing his very unkempt mane towards the zebras. They're now moving off. I'll just keep you posted. They're moving off to the right of us. What number are they at, Graham? At about 7:30 to us now, so moving past the back of the car. He's sort of looking in their direction. They're going to lose his scent now. But something's up with him. That ear is mangled. Looks like he's been playing in the front row of a rugby scrum for many years. I thought I might have been able to hear a lion way in the distance. Rachel, you say thank you so much for allowing people who cannot visit Africa the chance to experience it. Rachel, that's why we do what we do. And it's an absolute joy to bring it to you. It's not a trial. It hardly feels like work most of the time. And so really, it's not for us to, or for you to thank us. It's for us to thank you for watching, and especially for taking the time to send us your comments. So thank you very much for that, Rachel. Without you, we wouldn't have a show, would we? And so thank you for watching. And I'm so glad that you're enjoying being in Africa with us. The zebras are now going away again. They're now at 9 o'clock. So in relation to the lion, the lion's basically at 11 o'clock from us. And the zebras are at 9 o'clock. So he's actually looking at them. And just before you think I'm being a complete idiot by not knowing what Graham's to, or, you know, not being able to see where the zebras are, all I've got is that little screen that you can see when Jandre pans down to it. And it's almost impossible to keep your bearings on what's going on. There we are. Off to where they are. They're walking past these chaps, but they're probably how far? It's quite difficult to judge distance. What do you
think?
Okay, they've crossed to the other side of the road. Okay, Graham says they've crossed to the other side of the road. We're not far from the road now. Let's go back to the lion, see if he's decided to get up and follow. Goodness, wouldn't it be an amazing way to end this evening with a giant male lion on the hunt? Gosh, he looks absolutely set to by life, doesn't he? Yes, you do. There, you can see the broken tooth. There, he can see them now. Well, he can certainly smell them. I don't think they have any idea he's here. But there's no reason for them to come past here. So they're moving kind of on a trajectory that I think that's going to take them away from him. But we'll see. We'll sit here for a bit longer and see what he does. See if he actually gets up. Or if he just falls asleep again. Oh, what an interesting question. Fiona, you're in the United Kingdom. You say, I mentioned earlier that a little while back they stitched or darted and stitched Scarface up. And you want to know, do they intervene a bit more here in the Mara? I think you'll find the two reasons for that. Apparently they stitched up his eye, which had become quite badly injured. But as far as I understand, that's not the first time that he's had the attentions of the vet. So let me split this into two. The second time, I'm not sure how he injured his eye, but I think you'll find that his fame and his value as an attraction of tourists to this area perhaps would have made them err on the side of having him fixed up rather than just letting him go quietly into the night. You know how it is. Rich people are able to get good medical care, as are all celebrities. Scarface is no different. But the second time that it happened to him, as far as I'm aware, one of the great conflicts of this area, and it's an ancient one, is between the nomadic or pastoralist cattle herders, the Maasai people. And of course, there are no fences between their lands and the reserve. And Scarface strayed off into pastoral lands, and he fell foul of a Maasai warrior who was looking after his cattle, and he got a spear to the guts, as far as I understand it, and the vet was called in, fixed him up, and he was, you know, he survived okay. So I think that, you know, obviously would have been something they would have done in the Sabi sand as well. Absolutely, they would have helped a lion that had been hurt by human effect. Yeah, look, I said he had a belly on him. He doesn't look hungry. He certainly is on the move now. Let's just see if he goes anywhere. He's got a limp, too. Well, let me just wait. Here we go. Wonderful. My reputation as the bush laxative precedes me, and I have now succeeded in making a Mara lion times two go to the loo on live television. Well done, James. It's so nice to have such an incredible talent. It really is. There you are. Gosh, what a picture. Thank you, Jandro. It is amazing how that happens. I have to barely look at an animal before it will do precisely what this one just has. See if he actually moves now. Or goes fast asleep. Or starts perhaps to roar. He's looking after those zebra, you know. His mate, however, what's he doing, Jandro? The other one's head is up too. Oh, there we go. Back down to sleep. Let's keep watching and see what happens. You will see some light probably filling the screen. That is a vehicle coming along the main road now. Probably some rangers out on patrol. Doing roughly Mach 3. No, that's not fair. They're not actually going too fast at all. And I'm just thinking, I don't think they would have seen us, you know. We've got these infrared lights on. Their beams didn't hit us at all. So I don't think they would have seen us at all. He's gone back to sleep. Anyway, that's the one we think is called, what is it again? I've forgotten it now. Morana, that's it. That's who we think it is. Brother to Scarface, the great lion of the Mara Triangle. They're one of the blonde usurpers. Where the other blonde usurper is, we don't know. Scarface is knocking about this area somewhere. Maybe the blonde usurper had best watch his back. I suppose as should Morana, given that he has seemingly betrayed his brother, his illustrious brother. Alrighty, these catties are flat. Let's head back to Taylor, find out if she's managed to find the Ninkapuma Pride or perhaps one of the Birminghams. In the meantime, we'll sit with these great males and see if they bother to get up. Everyone, we're going to sit here for another few minutes with these lions, but basically we're going to call it quits for the evening. We're going to head back up to Ngama Mara, the most magnificent lodge in all the world, possibly, and there we shall recline, much like these lions are doing right now. Tomorrow night, of course, we will be out, and we're probably going to push it a little bit longer. We may do a bit more darting between the prides and see if they don't kill, especially as they all seem to have killed today. And perhaps tomorrow night they'll be a little bit hungrier. The Kitratembo pride certainly didn't kill an adult. They killed a very small animal earlier today, and so maybe they'll be hungry. Maybe they'll come back to this area. Maybe that female lion that we had the other day with Morana there will be back. Who knows? We don't know what's going to happen. Anyway, from the Mara Triangle, that is going to be it from us for the day. It's been a magnificent day of much death and mayhem, but also much beauty, much beautiful, beautiful scenery, the incredible stories of the migration being told before us by the earth as those incredible animals went to and fro across the river, and unfortunately many of them, well, they found a new home in the deep, but many have made it away. Anyway, that's going to be it from us. Thank you very much for watching. A big thanks to Jean-André and Graham and Emily in the back, to Daniel down here, and of course to the whole crew there in the Sabi Sands. We will see you tomorrow at, 4 o'clock East African time, 3 o'clock Central African time, and we'll push it, hopefully, with a line kill live. Bye-bye.